Welcome back this evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Chris from Writers Centre Norwich, and it's a pleasure to welcome you to the final event for Norwich on this Saturday. We've got one more day of events tomorrow, but today the culmination of our event is a fantastic conversation this evening. Nicci Gerrard, Sean French, writing as Nicci French, and hosted in conversation with Peter Robinson. This is our new home, as those of you who've been here today have heard about, and I think it just looks particularly spectacular in the evening when it's lit like this. You get a sense of how it must have been in the 1400s, of people coming from all over Norfolk and the East Anglia to this place to purchase their cotton and their goods. And what's one of our main ambitions as Writers' Centre Norwich over the next 2 years to turn it back into a place of exchange, but a place of literary exchange rather than a commercial exchange, to make it a national centre for writing, to have writers and translators living and working here and really working with everyone who visits and works in and lives in Norwich. It's a huge pleasure to thank also our partners in this evening's events and this weekend's event, Dead Good Books and University of East Anglia, whose new low residential creative writing MA has just started this weekend. I think Henry's students are probably kind of suffering from sort of a crash of overload at the minute, but stay with us, guys, it'll be fine. We'll have a Bloody Mary's in the morning. Bloody Mary's in the morning to poke you up. Nicci French is the writing team of Nicci Gerrard and Sean French. They're writers absolutely at the top of their game. The crime writer Sophie Hannah is actually quoted on the front of their latest novel saying, describing their work as sophisticated, gripping, addictive, and head and shoulders above the rest. It was actually Sophie Hannah who gave me my very first Nicci French novel. I think it was Killing Me Softly, I think it was. And I was staying in her house, and my strongest abiding memory, apart from the sort of the thumping heart that I remember in the last sort of two chapters, was being awake at 4:30 in the morning and putting the book down and thinking, I'm not going to sleep until at least 7 o'clock now. I didn't. But since then, I've read the novels, and they are genuinely some of the best that you can find. Our second guest, you're not our second guest, you're our third guest. You are two people. Right. I'm not going to continually...
I'm two in one.
We'd like to become Peter and Robinson.
Right.
Peter is the author of the immensely sort of best-selling... is an English-born but Canadian author who splits his time between Canada and North Yorkshire.
You are two people.
I am two people.
Yes. He's the author of the incredible Inspector Banks series. Now, I thought the 22nd had been published this year in paperback, but you think it might be the 20th?
Might be the 23rd.
23rd. I'm going to decide that Peter's probably...
Or maybe I just finished the 23rd. I don't
know. I'm going to cede authority to Peter in this, given that he actually wrote them and I only read them. But I did think it was worth pointing out that this evening, for the first time in this country, Peter's 1995 novel, No Cure for Love, is now available for the first time in the UK in hardback, and Waterstones have that at the back. On that point, Waterstones are selling and will be selling the books afterwards, and the authors will be happy to sign for you. It's going to be a really simple format this evening. There's going to be a conversation between our three authors of two novel outputs about where they've come from, how they write, why they write, and then an opportunity for you, the audience, to ask the questions that I'm sure are percolating through your minds after the recent day's events. So please welcome Nicci French and Peter Robinson.
Well, I think what we first thought is each of us will say a bit about how we got going and stumbled into this genre. So,
over to you.
Okay. The reason I went to Canada years ago was to do a master's in English and creative writing, and Joyce Carol Oates was teaching the course, and they had a poster on the wall in the English department at Leeds University, where I did my BA. And showed this lovely ivy-covered building in a place called Windsor, Ontario. So I went to Windsor, Ontario, and there is one ivy-covered building in the whole place. And I did the master's. My intention was to come back, teach, write, and I was writing poetry at the time. But it never happened. I couldn't get a job here, so I ended up staying in Canada longer and longer. So now I have dual citizenship. So that's why I'm sort of split in two there. But I came to crime honestly And it was through reading. I just got addicted. One, I was back in Leeds, it was one rainy day. My dad always loved May Gray and Raymond Chandler. And he had this Chandler omnibus lying around, which had three novels in it. And I had nothing to do, and I just sort of picked it up. I mean, I was a literary snob at this point. I mean, I only read Eliot, Joyce, not Finnegan's Wake, but you know, the other stuff. And I'd never read any crime fiction since I read The Saint and James Bond when I was a teenager. But here was this book, and I thought it looked interesting. I started reading The Little Sister, and I was just hooked. I mean, and I read all three of the novels in the Chandler omnibus. And then I went on to read all these May Grays, and I just read everything I could get my hands on. And after I'd read hundreds and hundreds of crime novels, I thought, you know, I could have a go at this. I could do as well as some of these, if not better. And at that time, there really weren't a lot of detectives in Yorkshire. And I was sort of homesick. I'd not been in Canada that long. So it seemed quite natural to me, you know, to spend my time there dreaming about being back in Yorkshire. So I came up with Banks after three or four books that are still in the bottom drawer and should be burned, actually. and that's sort of how it happened. And
so was that like 22 years ago?
Is
it
that was in the early 80s. Mm. Yeah, so it's more than that. And the first book was published in 1987. Mm. And you?
Yeah, well, I think ours is a bit more convoluted. When Nicci and I met in like 1990 and got married, and we were at that time we met because we were both on the New Statesman magazine, so we were both journalists, and right from the beginning of our marriage, you know, we were both writers, and you know, so I would, you know, if I was writing an article, I would always show it to Nicci before I sent it in, and we'd always do, and we were saying we were also both passionate readers, and we sort of passed books between us, and because of that, I think there was a sense that, you know, we used to have a conversation about, well, we're both writing, would there be some way that in the future we could actually write together? And it was something we were interested in, and then at a certain point we read this article that was in the New York Review of Books about this big new controversy. So this would have been about 1994, about recovered memory. I don't know if people have heard about this. What it was is people almost entirely in America were going into therapy, and women almost entirely, and discovering suddenly these memories of horrific abuse in their childhood. And as a result of these memories, people, family members, fathers, uncles, friends were being arrested and imprisoned. And there was a huge controversy about this. Were these real memories? Were they in some ways, you know, made up? And as writers, we had this sort of almost kind of double reaction, which is first thinking, you know, God, what a terrible tragic situation. And the second reaction is, God, what a great subject for a story. And
there was a third reaction, I think, which is a very useful reaction, which is that if we don't... So it felt like a new kind of thriller where you could both have something in kind of there in the external world and also about the internal self, the kind of strange labyrinths of the mind. And we thought, this is a fabulous subject for a thriller. And if we don't write it, somebody else will write it. So it was like a kind of rocket to us. And probably lots of people in the hall would agree that there's never a right time to begin writing, except now. Often you put off writing and think, well, I'll do it when I have more time or more money or more space, or I've done all the research I need to do. But actually, this meant that we did it just, we had to do it at once. And in fact, we did meet somebody at a party for kind of just after our book came out, and they were very angry with us because they said they were halfway through their book about recovered memory when ours came out, so we got there first.
And then we could go on about the kind of means of writing. I mean, I'm very curious. So you were writing in Canada about, you know, you were always going to write about Yorkshire, were you?
Yeah. I mean, that was my plan from the start. And you know, people often ask me, have I written anything set in Canada? Well, I've written quite a few short stories set there. And I did have part of an early Banks novel set in Toronto. I sent him over in the Hanging Valley for about a third of the book. And I really wanted to kind of put, you know, through his voice, my first impressions of being in Toronto, especially. How big everything is, the cars and all that kind of stuff. So I did that, but you know, the idea for a novel set in Canada has just never occurred to me. And I think I got going with Banks and really got into the characters in the series, and it was a way of staying in touch with a place. It sort of helped me deal with the homesickness and stuff. You know, because I could sit there on a winter's day in Toronto and imagine myself in the Yorkshire Dales.
So it's a way of remembering it.
In a way, it's a way of being close to it and keeping it close when I was far from home. Yeah, that's how it started.
Was there ever a problem writing about it in Canada when you're writing about Yorkshire? So you can't go think, oh, yeah, what's that place look like? Have to wait till next year until I go there.
That is a problem. And I got, you know, most of the sort of emails or comments I get was, oh, you've got someone driving the wrong way up a one-way street in Harrogate. Mea culpa. I mean, yeah, I did it. So there were little things like that. But on the other hand, when I've written about places that I've been in, I've found it quite constricting in the sense that I've actually had to go out and make sure shops are in the order I've put them in. And somehow writing about Yorkshire from a distance, writing about also a made-up dale and a made-up town, it stops me from being a slave to geography.
Presumably you're writing about a Yorkshire that's lodged in your kind of your youth and your memory. And so it's a bit like Joyce writing about, you know, when he wrote Ulysses.
Dublin from afar.
He had to write about Dublin once he left Dublin. He probably couldn't have written it if he'd been there.
Or Wessex or Bassetshire
So maybe we could then say, well, about why we, because you talked about why you did the thriller. And in a way, the idea we came across was a kind of thrillerish idea. But I think also, I think we were clear that there was a feeling, I think, that if Nicci, if we were going to collaborate, and it seemed like such, I mean, when we wrote our first book together, it was really, it wasn't like, you know, hey, wouldn't it be interesting to have a career writing together? It was more like a real experiment to see, could we, the two of us, sit down, write a book that we could actually finish and would somehow feel like a real story. One basic idea was that we needed to have a sort of a form that was basically, you know, plot centred, story centred, because because if we were going to be both writing into this sort of structure, we needed something that had a proper structure.
Then it's interesting. So in a way, we wrote a thriller because we needed to have a structure. We became Nicci French because we needed to have a female narrator for the first book, because that's who recovered memories happened to. And so it's almost, you know, when you recount it like that, that sounds like it's a kind of series of random events that created this writer called Nicci French. On the other hand, you know, we were talking earlier about why the thriller form apart, and kind of why is the thriller form so popular now as well. And for us, there were kind of various things to say about that. One is that it's, in a way, it's become our way of exploring the world together. So the things that make us anxious, or the things that make us curious, or the things that we can't find an answer to, the things that terrify us, that's our way of trying to kind of negotiate our way through that. And also, again, we were talking about this earlier, about how now, you know, we live in a world, you know, there's not much God left. There's not much belief in authority. So the kind of the gods, the priests, the belief in your kind of doctor, the belief that there'll be a lover who will come and rescue you, the belief there is a kind of a kind of absolute structure which you can rely on, that seems to me to have gone. And the thriller form is very good at trying to explore that new world, which is a world in which you have to rescue yourself and you have to make up your own mind.
Now were you both interested in psychological, psychiatric aspects, right from before you started writing? Because you know the character who is a psychiatrist. Yeah.
Well, that was, but that came later. I mean, in a way, because it's interesting that you've written with a central character. We've almost had two separate careers. Yeah. So the first, it's funny how you sort of find yourself becoming a certain kind of writer. And as Nicci says, in a way, because the subject of our first book demanded it was told by a woman, and so that, as Nicci said, that was why we took the name Nicci French rather than Sean Gerrard. And then we found ourselves writing stories with women as their main character. And in a way, we didn't write procedural stories because what we wanted to do was ordinary people suddenly finding themselves not realizing they were in a thriller suddenly, ordinary people to whom weird things happen. So that was, in a way, that's what we did for the first half of our career. Yeah. And then we came across a kind of character who we then, wrote about, the therapist who we've written about. And it's interesting. I mean, one of the things we could talk about is how, when you write a series, when you have the same characters, it's a very different kind of way of writing, isn't it? Because you follow people through and they sort of gently, you have a certain cast and a certain setting.
Yes, so now you're 22 books in, or 23 books in, or however many books in you are. And so you must intimately know your inspector and your landscape and the cast around him.
Yeah, I mean, to some extent, I've done three non-series books which I've enjoyed tremendously, one of which is the latest one that's set in Los Angeles about a stalker, and it was written 20 years ago and that was very much in the news. But the serious thing is, I feel I get the best of both worlds. I mean, yes, over time I've got to know Banks and some characters. I mean, characters come and go. I mean, if you don't like someone, or if a character's not really coming alive, I can kill him off. I've done that. Detectives, dead, boring. And others come to the fore. And in the latest Banks book, which was last year, here at Abattoir Blues, it's a lot of it's about Winsome, who had not really had, a big story before, and we find out more about her. So having a team, it stops me getting bored, because I can play with the characters. But also, every book has got a whole cast of ordinary people who become somehow involved and meshed in whatever case Banks is dealing with. And Banks is a lens through which we look at these people.
And also, isn't you when you say over time, because in a way, what a series can do, so when we were doing our standalone novels, every a story came to an end, and a narrative voice came to an end, and it was when we kind of encountered Frieda Klein, we kind of thought she has to have more than one book. She has to have eight for some reason. And partly the reason for that is to just see how people change over time, see how people get kind of bashed about by their experiences. So presumably over 22 years, your character's pretty bashed about by their experiences.
Very much, yeah. I mean, especially if he's a policeman, and especially if she's a psychiatrist. I mean, as you say in the book, she goes into the darkest places in people's minds and lives with that. And Banks does in a similar way as a detective, with an interest in what makes people tick and everything. He finds himself in some really dark places, and it changes him. I mean, he's become, I think, a lot more melancholy as he's aged. He's become a lot more isolated.
More melancholy now. Is that you?
No, I'm a happy guy. You know that. No, perhaps. I mean, I think that, one of the most difficult processes of aging, if you just leave yourself and falling apart out of it, is the friends dying, which happens with alarming frequency as you get older.
Yeah.
And it can't help but make you a little bit melancholy, yeah. But, you carry on. And then Banks, on the whole, he has his little pleasures. He has his wine and his music and his the back garden of his cottage at night. Occasional relationships since his wife left him. I mean, he is not a miserable character, but he does tend to be a bit more philosophical, a bit more melancholy, and a lot more isolated than in the earlier books in the series. And that's
one of the fascinating things I think about the crime form is because I like lots of people, I grew up reading all sorts of crime books, and one of the ones are all the kind of, you know, the Agatha Christie, Dorothy Sayers, this kind of so-called the golden age detective stories, and at that time there were these really quite strict rules about how they should be written, and they were in a way one of the points where they were not meant to be too literary. You're not meant to give too much attention to character, you know. It's just and in fact, I think even there was a way in which a lot, I think for quite a lot of people, quite a lot of readers, almost read the books in the way that they might be doing crossword puzzles or something like that. It was like almost like a non-literary form. It wasn't meant to involve that, mm-hmm. you know. So, and there was this rather brutal separation between, you know, kind of literature and crime fiction. And they were slightly, you know, they had different kinds of covers, and they were kept in a different bit of the shop. And I think that more and more, I mean, in a way, that I think there never was much of a real division between them, actually. I mean, if you go back to kind of, you know, so many, there are a lot of great novels that are very close to, yes, as you were saying, mm-hmm. Simenon, I think, is one of the great writers of the 20th century. Mm-hmm. And but I think, you know, what we've found more and more is that, you know, that there are, because sometimes when we've been interviewed, people think, you know, do you feel constrained by, you know, the kind of things you can't do, and I think there's nothing, if you have some interesting idea, there's nothing you can say, no, wait, this is the kind of wrong, you know, this is too complicated for it.
Or too,
you know,
dark, or...
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
No, I mean, I mean, certainly the Bank series is important to me, but the times that I've had a really strong idea that wouldn't work in a Banks novel, I've gone and done it, and, you know,
there are things that wouldn't work in a Batman.
Yeah,
okay.
Yeah. I mean, especially, although I did learn, when I did a book called In a Dry Season, I brought a story from the past into it, you know, which really interested me, and I found I really enjoyed doing research into the fairly recent past. So I did a book a couple of years ago called Before the Poison, which was a non-series book. And it was about a man who became obsessed with a woman who'd been hanged for murdering her husband. But part of its set is a sort of mock-up of the trial in the 50s. Part of it is her journals during the Second World War when she was a Queen Alexandra's nurse. And part of it is a guy in the present living in her old house in Richmond trying to put it all together. And that wouldn't work in a Banks book, you know. It's a bit more experimental.
Yes. Mm. Yeah. So with you're number 23. So we know that we're writing 8 books. This is 7, you know, it's all named after the days of the week. Mm-hmm. But nevertheless, there
is
are
that all you can do, though?
Books.
I mean, what if people want more?
Then I'm very sorry.
Oh, it's like the Sue and the alphabet.
Right? Well, except it's 8. So we have like an arc of a kind of one big story, kind of holding these 8 but 8 standalone books within that, and we know where we're going.
Now,
we know there's an end.
You've worked that out.
So we've worked out the arc, and then we have these standalone books. So do you have any sense of, is there any end point?
None at all. I don't know where my books are going to end. I don't know where the series is going to end. I don't plan. I don't outline. Don't do any of that. I just...
You never... So when you set off, you haven't got an outline?
No,
this is a good point to actually, because we should talk a bit, because we talk a bit about the different ways, because I bet we have a different way of writing than you do.
Probably do.
So maybe, because I think one of the interesting, I think one of the real advantages of, I mean, I think that especially in a, you know, in a genre where the story is always, you know, however experimental you're being, the story is really important. And there's a way in which, I think there's a kind of, being with two people, there's a way in which, I'm not allowed to get away with something, because Nicci, I have to convince Nicci of something. And do you have anyone you bounce off when you're writing, or do you show these people?
No, I mean, for me, it's like I begin a journey, an exploration of something, and if I knew where it was going to end, I'd be bored before I started.
Oh, so
do you know at all what the journey is going to be?
No.
That's so interesting.
What I usually have, and this is very important to me, I have to have, is a place where it opens, and usually there's a body in the place. I mean, let's face it, I go on walks around Yorkshire Dales, and when I get to a really interesting spot, my first thought is, wouldn't this be an interesting place to find a body? Not everyone thinks that in the Yorkshire Dales.
Some murderers,
you know,
do, yeah.
Some murderers. But it does. I mean, it really is very much it comes from a place, and then you have a body.
Yeah, that's fascinating. Can I interrupt for one second?
Yeah.
Is something that so much when people talk about crime fiction, there's so much talk about the story and the forensic details and things like that. And I sometimes think the setting is more important than anything else.
The setting is essential.
Because actually, and so many of the really, you think, going back to the kind of Sherlock Holmes or the Simenon things, what you think of is the atmosphere of them. Don't you think of the particular, you know, this kind of northern France with Simenon, or the, you know, the streets
and the
Philip, you know, the Philip Marlowe in you know, the Los Angeles, and you can just go through all the, you know,
right. The sense of place is very strong, and that's usually what I start with, you know. And
so do you start writing with that?
Yeah.
Do you then in your head know a bit what's going to happen?
Yeah,
or you just
I have to write
find
that,
out?
You see, because and then there's a victim there, and as soon as I start fleshing out who's being killed, then questions as to why and who might have done it start to come up. Banks asks them, radiates out.
So do you find out through the writing of it? That's what I'm saying. So you find out by writing what's happening.
Yeah, I find the best ideas come to me when I'm actually writing rather than sitting back thinking about what I should write.
So do you never, I mean, that's great, can I say, because it's someone who's very frightened by the process of constructing stories.
Well, how do you do it?
Well, we'll say in a second. I mean, I think that's great, and I think I know exactly what you mean, because we certainly find, however much you plan, there's a certain way, once you start writing, often you'll find the plans don't work, or the story just does carry you, and the characters just do carry you in a certain way, or refuse to do certain things. I mean, I suppose the danger sometimes is you can set yourself a problem that you yourself can't solve.
I'm not saying there aren't bad days. There are bad days, but you know, you just have to get over that. I mean, you do set yourself problems. You write yourself into a corner. You think, like, how am I going to get out of this? I'll never get out of this. Well, maybe 2 days later you do, you know, it comes to you in your sleep, or you go for a walk, and right, okay, that's going to go. And something suggests
because I remember, you know, in a way, an analogy with the thing that you started as a poet. I just remember you saying that the knack for writing the rhymed couplets, the kind that Alexander Pope wrote, is to write the second line first, and then, because you can have your dodgy rhyme can come first, and then it feels good when you get to the good, you know, the thing you're heading for. And I mean, I would say, we could talk a bit how we write together first, but just over, I think on the whole, the very first book, because when we were writing it, and we were absolutely, we thought, is this going to be possible at all? So in that particular case, it's the only time we really did do a chapter by chapter breakdown
right.
for the whole story and maps and things like that, just to be sure. But now we tend to have a pretty good knowledge of where we're heading for. So, you know, I think because just...
Or some novels demand much more planning than other novels, or in our case. So we wrote one novel in which it was called Losing You, and it was set in kind of real time. So it was like one long camera take. And everything, there was not a single second pause in it. So everything that the narrator went through was shown. And there were no chapters, and there was no gap at all. And the timing in that was crucial. So the planning for that was like a military operation. Kind of every minute had to be accounted for. And then there are some novels which you kind of have to feel your way through more. But we always do have a sense. It's a bit like we don't have a kind of synopsis of chapter by chapter.
Right.
But we do have a sense of what the journey is. We have a sense of why this novel has to be written, first of all, almost like what the beating heart is. What's it about? And underneath the plot, what's it about? What kind of dread are we exploring? What kind of human emotions are going to be kind of pulsing away there? And then we have to have a story. So not a detailed story, but we know what the journey of the characters is going to be and where they're heading for. And then we kind of write our way through that.
Well, I think I do the same thing, but just in a different way. I mean, I get a sense of what the theme's going to be as soon as I've done the opening scene. The place is important. I get the character, and then you know I start thinking it's really about this, isn't it?
And
I get ideas what it's
and
about, and that suggests more plot. To
and
me,
I think that one of the great, you know, there are terrible days of writing where it's like kind of walking uphill through glue, pulling a dead donkey, kind of, you know, and you've written less words at the end of the day than you had at the beginning.
And they're all crap.
And then there are other days where the writing seems to be taking you to places you had no idea that you wanted to go to, but you do want to go then. And that's extremely exciting. And also, there is that sense, which I've talked about with lots of writers, feel like somehow you sometimes you don't know, sometimes till halfway through the book, and sometimes almost till the end of the book, what you were writing mm-hmm. and why you were writing it. There's almost like a shadow book hiding under the book, and you suddenly realise what the real subject was all the time, and you didn't know it, but somehow it knew it, and it was taking you.
Well, that's what's exciting about it. I mean, sometimes I think we might stress how much hard work it is sometimes. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, it is hard work writing a book, and you do make false steps, and you do have to, you know, you sometimes come to a sort of brick wall, and you have to somehow deal with that, and you can spend days trying to get around some of these problems. But I mean, why we do it is at its best, it's so exciting.
It's so exciting.
Yeah, because you don't know what you're going to find around the next twist.
Also, it's hard work, but the very good, when we're writing together, I can be lying in a bath and Nicci French is still writing.
Oh, I like that.
maybe we should say just look quick before we get, you know, before people, we'd open up and if people want to ask questions, we could say just a little quick thing about how we actually do write together. Because,
yeah.
Nicci and I were both used to writing separately, but then we then really have to think, it's all right, one thing to have the idea, but how are we actually going to write this thing? And we started writing the first book, it was at the beginning of 1995, so that's like 20 years, and the one thing we've never done is actually write together. We've never sat in the same room and written together with what is, you know, I mean, I sometimes think of like people writing, you know, movie scripts with one person is a typewriter and another person walking up and down and you're kind of firing lines at each other. Nothing like that. So what happened is we've always done this. We do the research and the preparation and everything, all of that together. But then when we start writing, one of us will write, you know, start writing a bit, chapter or whatever, and then pass it over to the other who's free in theory to kind of change, edit, add, cut, whatever. And then we'll carry on, write some more, send it back, and then that other person can do the same thing. And which people may start to realise that it's not a quick way of writing a book. In fact, I think it's probably a slower way of writing a book than someone doing it on their own. And we pass that back and forward until we've finished the first, finished the first draft, and then and then constantly we're sort of discussing it as we're writing it, and then one person will go revise the whole book, and then the other person will revise the whole book, and so it's...
We have, like, I think we have two or three rooms. I mean, it sounds neater than it is, that process. It's quite kind of a messy process. But we have a couple of rooms. One is that we never tell anybody who wrote which bit. So nobody... And actually, sometimes people think they know, and about 50% of the time they get it right. That's almost because it feels like something would unravel if we started saying, well, I own that bit or he owns that bit. So we both have to own it. So even if I change nothing, if what Sean sends me, I think, is so wonderful that not a single comma needs changing, just by the act of accepting it, it becomes mine as well. So, and the other rule is, that if I send something to Sean, which I love very much, and when I get it back from him later, he's changed it all and written his own things over the top of that, I'm not allowed just to change it back. That's kind of breaking some kind of unwritten contract. And I think there's a third rule, which is that we don't sit down beside each other and show me. If I write something and Sean summons me and says, this bit I don't like and this bit, it's done kind of invisibly. So I write in an attic at the top of the house and Sean writes in a shed in the garden, and very gendered, and we email it back and forth to each other and kind of just change it.
I think we could not have collaborated with old technology, because one of the great things about, you know, is it's sort of invisible, you know, because if you're just re-changing on a computer, you know, it sort of vanishes, the thing that the other person's done. Whereas if I had handed Nicci typed bits of paper and they came back with scrawls across it and huge crossings out, I think that would have been too painful. But I think that we've known one or two other people trying to collaborate, and they've usually had a flaming row on the first sort of day one, and that's the end of it. I mean, I think if I really felt that Nicci was trying to sort of take this book and turn it into her book, and didn't much care for the one I had in mind, and there was a sort of battle for control, then we would never have written the first book, you know. So there is a trust that when Nicci's vandalising my prose, that she's doing it in the service of, you know, this book that we've both talked about, and but, you know. So without that, it wouldn't
I thought you just wrote alternate sentences. or I'm not feeling up to it today. Just write me a bit of description.
One other thing, there's no division of labour, so there isn't, because I know other people who've collaborated, and they usually, for example, the really good, the Swedish couple, Sjöwall and Malö, who wrote in the 60s and 70s, and that, you know, I think that he wrote the kind of more procedural stuff, and she wrote the more kind of literary things. We both do all the research.
So it's not that Sean does the car mechanics, I do the makeup.
we never know in advance who'll write it. For me, on that very happy note, maybe if anyone has any questions, maybe someone back.
Down there. Not to pry into your personal life, but what happens when, say, you have an argument? Because obviously, everyone has arguments in relationships, marriages, particularly some time. So you have this argument, say, that has nothing to do with your work. And then you're up there working, emailing stuff back and forth. Does it impact on your attitude towards that work that then turns up?
Hypothetically.
So you're saying, I'm being clear, so it's not about whether we argue about the work. If we've had a terrible round and I'm having to go and try and write and then hand it to this unreasonable woman, you mean that kind of thing? How would that work? Would that be possible? Nicci?
You started. Sean kind of sulks and I argue, so it's very unsatisfactory. But that's
I think it's funny that the things that people say a couple of times, people have said to us. Firstly, you must be so mature in you must have this perfect marriage because you can clearly never argue because you can collaborate. So we're not. It's just like anyone else. It's just as messy and squabbly as anyone else. And the other thing is, people think it's so miraculous. You must have this identical prose style that you can somehow collaborate. And again, we're very different writers, really. But
when we write separately. Well, I would say there are a few answers to that. One is that I think that over the last 20 years of writing together, there have been little hiatuses where nothing has been written at all. But also, because we've been kind of not getting on with each other or squabbling or not being able to agree on something, and so we've gone into kind of huffs, and I'm sure that's true. But the other thing, which is probably more accurate about what often happens, is that actually you can escape into writing. So when we're writing as Nicci French, if I've had a squabble with Sean and I'm writing, I can kind of get away from that squabble and go somewhere that's a bit more kind of grown up and disinterested.
Yeah, go in just and kill someone on the page, torture someone,
Can I just add not back to the Peter out there? Peter, could you imagine collaborating with someone on your next novel?
Oh, I have enough arguments with myself, it is. I sometimes suspend operations for a while. It would be difficult. I mean, my wife's been suggesting that we collaborate using my mother's maiden name and her mother's maiden name, which would be Jarvis Wigmore. So watch out for Jarvis Wigmore. But I don't know. I mean, it's not something I've ever done. And, I've talked about it with people over the years, and it scares the agents to death. If I talk to Ian Rankin and say, look, let's do a Banks and Rebus story. They get together and whatever. We have the same agent in America. He said, no, we don't. I mean, it terrifies them, that kind of idea. But that's a little different, that's mixing your characters and just writing another book with someone else. I kind of like the way that you talked about how you work, and I find that interesting. And it's not just, like James Patterson gets other people to write his books and you write different bits. You go over each other's bits and you may change things, pass it back and forth. I think it would be an interesting process.
I think it often seems weird to other people, but it really feels weird to us, I think, as well. Mm-hmm. If I'd been told, 25 years ago, that I would be the main, my main activity would be writing fiction in collaboration with someone. I would have thought that sounds insane, and how, you know, how could any, you know, how would that really work? And even, but even when we've done it, it feels a bit like that. It's a, I mean, I suppose writing is a mysterious process, but, mm-hmm. but collaboration is.
Also, I think with collaborate, I mean, I think what it feels like is very, very vulnerable. The act of, because you know when you write and somebody looks at your work and kind of. changes bits, it feels it's very hard to cope with that, and so it's such an act, a collaboration involves kind of a bit of a loss of ego,
mm-hmm.
and also it involves this huge amount of trust that you have to, not just trust that together we can make it better than it would be if we were writing just not together, but also trust that, I don't know, there's something about kind of you're exposing yourself and you're mm-hmm. not going to be kind of trampled over.
But do you have particular people, or a particular person or something that you show when you've, I don't know, either halfway through or even when you finished?
No, when I think I'm finished, I show it to my wife and she's the first reader, yeah. and she's quite vicious.
So you do, so yeah, so you try, so you'll...
Yeah, but I mean, that's when I think it's ready and yeah. I yes. find out that it's not. Mm. I once made the mistake of sending in, because I was a little bit late, like a half a novel, I hadn't written the second half, to an editor and for comments and stuff. And it really messed me up for yeah. the second half. Yeah. So I would never, mm-hmm. ever yeah. show yeah. somebody something unfinished.
Mm-hmm. So in a way,
is there any kind of general correlation between a crime writer's levels of happiness and the body count in a book?
We don't have a lot of bodies, I don't think. I mean, you know, if you look at my books, there's usually a Banks book a year, more or less. And there may be, it's rare that there will be more than one or two bodies in each book, which is probably the murder count for the Yorkshire Dales in a year. It's not unreasonable. It's not like Colin Dexter in Oxford.
No, slaying everybody.
Do you know, I don't know whether it's therapeutic, but there was one that Philip Larkin said in one of his letters, he really didn't understand how people who weren't writers, what did they do with their experience when things happened to them? How were they able to deal with not being able to turn it into literature? And there is a way in which there's something, and you know, whether that may not be healthy, it's probably much healthier just to have a life and just have real experiences and not have a little filter that's constantly with everything that happens thinking, well, maybe we could use it, you know, could this person be as, you know, but I think there is something very interesting in our relationship that, you know, when we come across ideas, when we talk about something, when we meet someone, we kind of think, you know, well, could we use that, you know, can we process that?
Also, and body counts in thrillers, they don't mean that a thriller is bleaker because there are more bodies. Often kind of more is less or less is more or whatever. But actually the things, if you, I don't know, probably most people in this room saw the killing.
Mm-hmm.
And that was just so riveting because it just fixed on this one thing and followed the human emotions attached to that and looked at people's faces and went inside their minds. And it was the kind of bleakest and most beautiful portraits of how people kind of fall apart in the aftermath of things, which is what I think we're interested in, is like aftermath, really.
Mm-hmm.
And kind of and human dread. And that, and often if there are kind of like, if there's kind of 20 hours to save the world and people are dying all over the place, that's rather jolly usually because it's just not real.
Sorry. Anybody else?
I'm sorry, so there's first some right at the back.
Sorry, I wanted to ask a question about characters and choices. Frieda Klein, which I always think is such a brilliant name for psychologists and psychotherapists. You said earlier that you knew at one point that there was more than one story by her voice, and I presume at some point when you discovered that, that's when you moved away from standalones to the serial. With Inspector Banks, with someone that you flourished you as a writer for a long time, your relationship with him again must be really solid as well. What was it that made you suddenly realise that Frieda was a voice that needed to be heard, and how so do you kind of carry on your relationship with Inspector Banks?
Shall I answer about Frieda? I mean, Frieda, I mean, it sounds kind of absurd in a way just to say that Frieda came to us, but she did, really. We had no intention of writing anything more than standalones for the reasons that Sean described earlier, that we wanted to see how kind of what happened to ordinary people who had extraordinary things kind of occur. And then we had the idea when we were thinking about, you know, our next book, we kind of were visited almost by Frieda. We had the idea of a woman who was a psychotherapist, and we'd always been writing psychological thrillers, and who didn't want to be a detective. She didn't want to be kind of, she believed that you can't solve, she believes that you can't solve the kind of chaos of the outside world. You can only address the kind of chaos of your own mind, and that's what you have to take responsibility for. And so she's someone who kind of wants the safety of her consulting room. And she was somebody who was had a very kind of sixth sense for other people's secrets, but was very good at kind of guarding her own secrets. And we kind of envisaged someone who was solitary and prickly and difficult, but honourable. And the more we talked about her, the more we just thought she just wouldn't divulge herself to us or the reader in a book. She just needs quite a lot of books in order to... I mean, in a way, when we're writing the Frieda Klein series, part of the story is about the story of her kind of strangeness. And so that's, you know, she came from that idea.
Banks, he's certainly changed. I had no strong idea of him when I first started writing. You know, the first book was published in 87, so... That was quite a long time ago. I did want him to grow old in more or less real time. And I say more or less real time, it's still fictional time. The books appear about a year apart, but he hasn't necessarily aged a year between each book. The cases don't take place a year apart. So I can always keep him a bit younger than me. I could make him older if I wanted, but that would, you know. So I can keep him the other side of retirement. And I can do other things to stop him from retiring. And I find that, oddly enough, I mean, he gets more interesting as he gets older. I find out more about him. He gets more involved with people. I mean, despite his melancholic and his isolationist sort of qualities, he does get very emotionally involved in the cases he works on. And he likes people, you know. And I think that you know, comes out in most of the books, that he's quite fascinated by, as Frieda is in a different way, the workings of the human mind. I mean, he's more, you know, more of a layman who's just really interested in why people are doing what they're doing and thinking what they're thinking.
Did you plan his backstory from the beginning?
No, it comes piecemeal, yeah. You know, sort of as it goes on. And I do find make-up bits of his past, you know, when I think, oh, it would be good if he had an incident with it. There's one thing I'd mentioned, a childhood friend who disappeared, and it had always, and it was just a bit of characterization in one book, backstory, and then I thought, well, if the body was found, that would be a plot for a later book.
The funny thing we found working
you
on the series,
seeds, yeah.
Is you both plant seeds, but you've got to be a bit careful which seeds, because you can, you know, and you suddenly see, you often see that in the kind of, in TV series, which run for a long time, that you can actually, you know, if you make a wrong decision, you can be stuck with it.
Yeah.
And so you have to be careful. You know, so see, sometimes there's a temptation to have some rather wild, weird thing happen, but then you've got to kind of bear the, you know, you've got to keep the consequences.
You can always change your mind. You know, readers don't notice. the one-way street in Harrogate. Yeah. But no, I mean, I had a problem there because I, being very clever, I made Banks come from Peterborough, where I was not too many hours ago. And I thought, well, I didn't want him to come from Leeds, where I grew up, because it would be too autobiographical. And I was really trying to get away from the autobiographical element. So having come from Peterborough, I'm called Peter, and it's Petersborough, and I invented him. And there's a Peterborough near Toronto in Ontario that actually has a Peter Robinson College, not me. So it just made sense, you know, he comes from Peterborough. But then when I did get to writing this story about his childhood friend who disappeared and whose body was found many years later, I realized that I knew nothing about Peterborough, not only in the present day, but in the 60s when all this was set. So I had to do a lot of research, and the Historical Society there was really helpful. And I actually had to go to Peterborough several times, which turned out to be quite all right, actually. I quite like it. And, you know, I got familiar with it and met people there. And, you know, they gave me all kinds of pictures of what it used to be like. And the book went from there. But, I mean, in some ways, I think that was creating extra work for myself. It was a bit of a misstep. If I'd had any sense, I'd have had Banks come from Leeds and bugger the autobiography, you know. I mean, you know. It was too clever by half.
There was a question
was someone
down
else
there.
Had a hand, put their hand up.
There we are, there's a hand there, yes.
Do you still write poetry? I don't. I mean, I do occasional jottings that I wouldn't think of publishing or, well, it wouldn't be publishable or showing to people. It was just an impulse that went into the prose. I mean, I got interested in writing poetry that had a strong sense of place, and even poetry with a narrative strand in it. And I think that, you know, a lot of that creative energy went into the book. So you will find a strong, sometimes poetic sense of place in the novels. And it doesn't leave me much left over except the occasional image that I can't really do anything with except write in my notebook. I still read a fair bit of poetry, but I don't write so much.
I just wanted to ask, in relation to creating strong characters like Klein and Banks, are they a constant voice in your head in terms of switching them on, switching them off? Across a number of years of writing, are they sort of like this silent twin that is...
That's such an interesting question. I mean, I think for us, there are two things. One is that kind of Nicci French, you know, the voice, because in a way, there's a voice of Nicci French as well. And I think I said earlier, that's been our way of kind of looking at the world together. But now with Frieda Klein, we do go around kind of... We always go around saying, what would Frieda do? What would Frieda think? So we are, in a way, there's a way in which, you know, we're seeing the world together and separately. And then we're seeing the world through Frieda Klein's eyes, which is like a kind of different kind of way. I mean, because she's such a kind of troubling kind of person to see. She doesn't believe in happiness. She's not a therapist who believes in happiness. She believes in kind of autonomy, I think. And so there's a way in which I think that recently we've maybe been seeing the world a little bit differently because of Frieda, because of this person we created between us.
Also, I think one of the things I think that if you write standalone books, you really do close off the story. And one of the almost always, although there's really a sense of you don't need to know anything more that's going to happen to this person. Their story is finished. But I think one of the points about a series is you really do acknowledge that, like life, there's never really an ending. You know, things always continue. Mm-hmm. So the characters stay, you know, they have to kind of stay with you in a certain way.
I got to the point where I can't think of an end for Banks. You know, I mean, there are times, you know, people say, well, are you going to end the series at some point? You know, like Ian Rankin ended Rebus, then brought him back again. Conan Doyle ended Sherlock Holmes and then brought him back again. Van der Valk ended, Nicholas Freeling ended Van der Valk and didn't bring him back, brought a much more boring detective into life. So, I mean, I do think about it, you know, and it's like, how would I get rid of him? And I can't now. I can't kill him off. That would be boring. I mean, everyone does that. I think perhaps the only way I could stop writing about him was having him get married to Annie and be promoted to chief constable. So he wouldn't do any investigating, he'd be happily married, I assume, and there'd be nothing more to write about. End of story. But I can't see that happening. So, you know, he keeps on going. And he will do for a while longer. But, again, I give him some things in common with me. So it's like Nicci was saying that partly I'm quite fine with him. Is we share musical taste and things like that. But again, looking at the world, I could not do his job. I could not be a police officer, a police detective, although I do think that, you know, writers and detectives have a lot in common. That there's the quasi-military element, and that they couldn't do the discipline, wear a tie, and even Banks doesn't like wearing a tie. You know, so there are differences, and looking at things through his eyes is not my way. So it forces me to look at things differently.
But it is so strange how a character that you make up becomes kind of so real. Real for readers if you've done it well enough, and real for you. And obviously, in some senses, they are you because you've made them. You know, in some senses, all writing is autobiographical in one way or another. So there's this creature you've created, and it's kind of gone out in the world, and it feels endlessly kind of magical, really, how the imagination can body forward these figures.
Well, of course, the other thing with the series is all books are a collaboration with readers, because every book, once people start reading it, it sort of somehow alters, even in your own mind, even if you've written it, because you see the way people react to it. But when you're writing a series, of course, people have you have this interchange where you start becoming aware of what people want or don't want to happen, or which characters they kind of respond to and which ones they don't. And mm-hmm. and it's a very different, I suppose in a way that's how you're almost going back to the tradition of novels in the 18th and 19th century, where they were appearing episodically. So suddenly these novelists like Dickens or whatever, were they kind of knew as they were writing that, you know, and so sometimes they had to kill off people because they kind of, yeah. You know, there's a famous character in them. I can't remember her name. This evil dwarf woman in David Copperfield, who he based very, very clearly on a real woman, and she got so hurt and devastated. There's a ridiculous bit later in the book where she suddenly turns out, it's called Rosa Dartle. She suddenly is made completely implausibly think, oh, actually, she was really nice all along. You know, in one sentence. And, you know, so there's that kind of. You know, but we never, you know, we base horrible characters on real people, we're always a bit cleverer. No,
really?
So the readers do kind of say to write to us saying that they really want, you know, Frieda and Carlson to be together, and what are we going to do about that, or please don't let anything bad happen to Joseph or whatever. So
it's great that readers take sort of proprietorship of characters and feel strongly enough about them to send me emails telling me what Banks should do and how he should get together with Annie. That's where his destiny lies. And
But then we all feel like that as readers. I mean, in a way, one of the things about, you know, certainly with us, we're as passionate as readers as we are as writers. And I know I get invested in characters, and you get really, and you can sometimes feel that an author can betray their own characters. You sometimes think they're not worthy of their own characters. You know, there are things where it can happen in series where things go, people make the wrong decision, and you suddenly get furious with the writer. You know, I know there was a wonderful piece in the. In the New Yorker about George R. R. Martin, about how his fans have now turned on him, and they can't, whenever he goes on holiday, they keep sort of sending him abusive messages, telling him to get back and carry on writing. You know?
Like he needs to. But yeah, another question.
Can I just ask Peter how all that relates to it now, Banks being on the television?
Well. Banks on the television is a different. I look at it as a parallel universe, in which Banks is like this and looks totally different from how I imagine him, and you know, gets involved in stories. And did anybody ever see Fringe TV series? It had a wonderful parallel universe story, and the same people existed, but they just looked that much different and. You know, the worlds were just that much different that you couldn't, you could cross from one to the other, but they couldn't, they coexisted, but they could never run together. And it's just the TV world. I mean, it's run by committees, its scripts are written, edited, changed, handed on, you know. I mean, it's just an endless process. It's a wonder anything ever gets done, to be honest. And then when they do film it, you know, it's like hundreds of people there doing technical jobs and then there's all the editing and stuff. So I mean, I don't feel it bears a great deal of relation to what I do.
How did you feel about Stephen Tomkinson in the role of Banks?
Well, I mean, I quite like Stephen as an actor and I'd seen him, I thought it was great in Brassed Off, but then he'd been in other things that I'd seen, but I didn't see him as Banks. But I think he's grown into the role to some extent. I mean, you know, it took a little while, but, you know, he was, he always wanted to play a tougher part, the detective, and when he got the role, he got in touch with me and wanted to get together and talk about the character, and read all the books, which is great. I don't suppose he bought them, but he read them. TV company would have bought them for him. And he did his research, and, you know, he did a great job. And I think as the series went on, he becomes better and better at playing Banks. It's not Banks, it's somebody playing Banks. And then I remind myself that even Banks doesn't exist, which is totally weird. You know. And so, but you know, it's gone away from the books now. And I don't know what's going to happen.
As readers, like I'm sure you do, I remember asking Ian Rankin many years ago about who he thought would do well as readers. And at the time,
John Hannah was doing it.
Yes, and he actually said that, I think somebody asked him who he thought could play Rebus, and he said Ken Stott. And I think Ken Stott then went on and was much more, in my view, what Rebus was really like.
Yeah, I mean, Ian was lucky, he got two goes at it, but the problem with the Ken Stott Rebuses was that they totally truncated the books. I mean, they did a whole novel in like an hour.
Yeah.
It was ridiculous.
It is,
yeah. Yeah, lost a lot. And it's a different world. You do have parallel universes.
Yeah, the problem, in a way, an adaptation. You know, a film is, or TV thing is such a different form. Mm-hmm. So it's always, so, you know, sometimes things are really good, or sometimes they're different.
They can be even better than the original.
And think of all the things, you know, like you say, I mean, to take obvious examples, like, you know, think of the Philip Marlowe adaptations. I mean, actually, Humphrey Bogart is nothing like, Philip Marlowe at all, but he's amazing, you know. And I think Raymond Chandler didn't like it, you know.
No,
didn't.
But then you got Robert Mitchum in Farewell My Lovely, who was terrific.
Yeah, but again, not because he's.
But not Marlowe.
Yeah,
no. It's never going to satisfy everybody, and it's a different audience. I mean, millions of people watch a TV program. If only they all bought one of the books, I wouldn't care who played Banks.
Perhaps one more question.
There's someone there.
Last one.
If you could go back in time, what advice would you give yourselves?
Why did we ask for that question?
You that killer question.
Do you know, that's almost a question for me and my therapist, because I think there are lots of things in personal terms I could think of. I think the Nicci and me writing together, you know, it's been so, in a way, it's been sort of weirdly kind of, you know, I almost think, thank God we embarked on this weird thing, you know. So, I mean, I wouldn't have to say.
Shall I go? I'll say.
I don't know, I
would say to that. I think, I think I didn't understand when we first set off on this strange journey together how weirdly lucky we were to kind of write together, then to find, you know, to find a publisher, to find readers. And I can now, looking back, I think, my goodness, you know, for 20 years we've been having this freedom to kind of make books and to kind of lead this life of the imagination. And I suppose I would just be more kind of amazed and grateful.
I thought there's one bit of advice. I've got very good. In fact, if they invent a time machine, I'm going to get into the time machine and do this. It's a bit related to what you're saying. You know, you see, when these people come to you and they say, offer to buy the film rights to Killing Me Softly, don't let them have them.
that's good advice. Yeah, it almost sounds like, what advice would you give yourself as a young writer? And, I mean, I always wanted to be a writer ever since I was like that high. And I never gave up on it. And, you know, I sort of tailored my life to do it. And you do it different ways. I mean, it seems to me most crime writers I know either come from a journalism background or from an English literature background.
Or both in our case.
Sometimes both, yeah. And so I applied for jobs at newspapers, you know, when I was school leaving age, the Ossett Observer and the Pontefract and Castleford Express. And I went for interviews, I didn't get the jobs. So then I thought, well, okay, I'll go to university. So I went and studied English literature instead, because I always wanted to be in the world of English literature, a writer. And you don't give up. You need, I suppose, you need some talent, but you need a lot of persistence and you need luck. And I've had luck. I was very lucky to get published. I think we all feel that, because I know that there are a lot of people who are trying and people think it's impossible. But it was, I hate to say it was relatively easy in my case, but I just phoned people and said I had this, were they interested, and I sent it to some Penguin Canada, and they ended up publishing it about 2 years later. But it went through a lot of changes since then. But I mean, you persist, and as Ed McBain once said, best advice to a writer, bum on chair, fingers on the keyboard.
But also just that, just to reiterate that, just never forget that we're lucky, because luck, I think that, people think they deserve their luck. I'm not sure I would ever think, I think there are lots of writers who are very good who don't get published. Mm. And so we're just, we should just remember that.
And there are really good books published that don't get the attention they deserve. Yeah. I mean, the problem is life is finite and you have many books, but there are, I quite often will read, I wish they did it, the Guardian used to do a really good thing that maybe they still do it at the end of every year, where they talk to different editors and different publishers, and they say, what have been the biggest disappointments of the year? What are the books they, and often people are quite honest, they'll say, they'll say some book they loved and just no one bought it. And quite often I've gone and then bought these books and read them, and you see these wonderful books, and you think, well, why did this, what was it? I'm fascinated in a kind of horrible way, both by, when books are really successful, I'd love to read them to kind of think, because, things are always successful for a reason, I think. There is, often there's luck in a way, but usually you kind of, you'll hit somehow touch a nerve. And then sometimes you think, on the other hand, there are these fantastic books that somehow they miss the boat. Maybe they arrive at the right time. They don't find the right readers, but it seems like just terrible luck.
It's nice when you discover one.
Yeah.
Novel Stoner was
crazy. Yeah.
It's wonderful, wonderful
novel.
Yes,
extraordinary.
Just ignored when it came out. Yeah. Mm.
Oh, sorry. We're going on and on. Right.
It's a brilliant place in a way to pause the notion that life is finite and there are only certain numbers of books you can read. Given that, I do encourage you to read more of the books of Nicci French and Peter Robinson. I'm going to go back and read more and reread with a much deeper kind of insight into what those books are and how you've written them. It's been a real privilege to listen to your conversation and to kind of overhear that conversation, to hear writers writing in similar ways, in different ways, and kind of dealing with some of the kind of the tropes and the genres that really turn us as readers into passionate lovers, as passionate you are as you are about your works as well. Thank you very much indeed, Peter Robinson and Nicci French.